We're about to put the boat in the water and head offshore. We'll put the mag in and hopefully identify some targets for us to dive later.
Running.
Yeah, our day starts. We stay at the Waddell Mariculture Center. It's a Department of Natural Resources facility that we stay at. Conveniently located next door is the boat ramp that we use, so we just drive around to the boat ramp at about 7:30. We're there, get the boat loaded, and then it's about, depends, 45 to an hour ride out to where we're going to survey offshore. For this search and our NOAA grant, we're searching from the entrance of the bay or the sound from Hilton Head and then Phillips Island are the two islands that form the mouth, and then out 7 miles to the shoals. And so our focus is very shallow waters and then a little bit of deeper waters as well, believing that, you know, the ships are striking the shoal and either they'll stay stuck on the shoal or perhaps they'll move along and into deeper water. So we're covering and blanketing this whole area with our remote sensing equipment. Take about 45 minutes, and then we'll set up a survey line and then throw out our magnetometer. And then we'll go back and forth for a little while for the rest of the day. So right now we're just setting up our survey software to tell us where to go. So we'll use two pieces of software, ArcMap that has all our survey data, so just opening that up right now. And then we also use it to steer, use it for our navigation charts, and so we'll be able to, helmsman will be able to steer. We knew through the historical record at least 30 or so shipwrecks had occurred in the area, ranging from the 16th century. Primarily wrecks are from the 18th century, a little bit in the 19th century as well. The one that's really our sort of holy grail wreck that we would love to find is called Le Prince. And it was a French corsair that had left France in 1577, sailed along the coast of the Spanish Main, so present day Venezuela and Colombia, attacking some towns and shipping within that area. They then moved into the Spanish West Indies, attacked Hispaniola, which is present-day Dominican Republic and Haiti, and then went to Cuba, and then had sailed up to St. Augustine and anchored there for about 4 or 5 days. And the townspeople were wondering what was going to happen. You know, I see this big, powerful corsair vessel bristling with armor and people. But apparently a storm kept the ship at bay, and then the vessel pulled anchor about 4 days later, and then sailed up to Port Royal, perhaps to refresh, meaning to get water, you know, some foodstuffs, trade with the local indigenous population before they went to France. And for some reason, they wrecked on the shoal. Why did they wreck? They were so careful off of St. Augustine, then they come to Port Royal and wreck. My thought is that the vessel is coming into the channel, and then a squall hit it. So something that they weren't quite prepared for just came in, very fierce, and then knocked them into the shoals. And it wasn't that violent of a wreck because everybody survived. And they were able to retrieve one large cannon and apparently get their muskets as well. So it wasn't a catastrophic wreck, but it was enough that they had to abandon the ship.
Seems that nobody died in the wreck, but the survivors then went and built a small fort somewhere in Port Royal Sound They sought out Santa Elena. They dug up cannons that the Spanish had buried and threw them into the water, and then took refuge among Indian towns around Santa Elena, where they stayed until the Spanish returned in 1577, and then spent the next 3 years tracking down every Frenchman who had survived the wreck of Le Prince.
The Spanish are just trying to methodically ferret the survivors out and to render justice for their crimes against the Spanish crown when they raided and traded. And so pretty much all the French survivors were rounded up, and some died in battle with their Indian hosts. Some were brought back to St. Augustine and hung. Some were reserved. The younger men were condemned as galley slaves and either sent back to the Mediterranean, or they stayed along the coast going from Cuba to, you know, the Florida forts. And so our survey strategy typically is, if we're working close to a shoal, if it's low tide, we'll start out in deeper water, and as the tide goes, we'll rise up and go over the shoal, or alternately we'll start on the shoal and work our way out as the tide goes on. And our boat speeds are about 6 to 7 knots, so pretty slow, and we go about spacing of every 20 meters, so sometimes it feels like you're never moving away from that channel marker, but eventually you get far away from it. And we just want a really fine grain survey this area to make sure we don't miss anything, because, you know, we may find not the wreck at some point, but we may find a scatter of material of a wreck as it moved across the shoal, and maybe eventually it will lead to the target. So we definitely want to, you know, be fine tuning in our survey. Well, this is all the stuff that we've surveyed to date, starting from our first forays back in 2001, mostly the orange, and then we've increased with our NOAA grant the green and the blue areas as well as the yellow. And so we hope to come back and finish this area, which is that you can see the nautical chart. And so we figure that's about 4 or 5 weeks to complete this area here. And this is about, you know, Hilton Head and St. Phillips Island, and Beaufort's up off the map. And this is about 3 miles wide. And so the coverage area is about 30 square miles or so. So we've covered quite a bit of our area. It's almost 3/4. And we just need to finish it off. And then once we find our targets, we'll start prioritizing them and then, you know, ground truth and see what those targets are. And so right now we're just in the searching phase. We call it prospecting phase, in which we're just going out with our boat loaded with all our equipment and just mowing the lawn back and forth, days, weeks, months, years. And hopefully, you know, by this methodical approach, we'll find Le Prince as well as the other wrecks that we'd like to find. Our primary tool is a cesium magnetometer, and that detects ferromagnetic materials, which are iron or steel, and which for a shipwreck, you have cannons, anchors, riggings, and even the ballast itself can be a little magnetic. So that will help us determine to find a wreck. We also use a side scan sonar, so that's acoustically picturing the bottom. So if anything's standing proud of the bottom, it'll be pictured by the sonar. In some cases, we'll also use a sub-bottom profiler, and so that sends a very narrow sound beam through the sediments, so if something's buried, it might be able to detect that. We're historical archaeologists, so we use a lot of historical materials, and so we've, you know, determined that, you know, Le Prince and all these other wrecks occurred. We also would like to see, you know, perhaps an X on a nautical chart or something like that, but we rarely get that, so we have to go through the historical materials to see if we can get some better location of where these wrecks occurred. And for instance, for Le Prince, back in like 1620, a Franciscan friar wrote that Le Prince wrecked a league from the shore, so about 3 miles offshore the wreck occurred. We also have a contemporary account that the poop deck, or the upper area of the ship, floated into the marsh. So that sort of put some, you know, wheels in motion that it had to have happened close to shore. And so now we know where we can sort of set up a block and then start surveying from there and just radiate out till we find it. Our goal is to find the archaeological site of the shipwreck. That's our main goal, and then from then we can sort of broaden the historical record. And we've contracted with a researcher in France. France at that time when you wanted to set up a voyage or whatever, you do similar to what you would do now. You set up a charter party, who's responsible for what you're going to do, what the voyage is. And so there's a document written on that. And then various other, who's going to victual it, who's going to provide foodstuffs. And so there's all these legal documents being written by what was called a notary public. So it's sort of a blend between a lawyer and a notary, and they're written in shorthand. So you have to know what is being written. So this person specializes in that, Dr. Bernard Allaire, and he's been able to just follow, get information, looking for le prince and trying to find that in the documents.
So I'm looking at French stoneware that was found at Santa Elena that will relate to the kind of pottery we expect to find on Le Prince. And that's how, when you find a shipwreck, one of the features you use to date the olive jar is the form of the rim and the neck.
After a day of surveying, we process the magnetic and acoustic data and distill the raw data into some meaningful data of what magnetic or acoustic anomalies could be of archaeological interest.
So one of the ways that we visualize the magnetometer data, apart from the driven lines, because obviously looking at those points, just off the bat, you can't tell anything from those. So we have a way of visualizing it called contour, and that shows the contour of the magnetic data, and when there is a high magnetic reading, you can actually see all of the lines kind of start to converge, and they'll show up really clearly as anomalies on the map.
So this is the sonar record that we collect from the hummingbird that we have on board. And so I'll look at this and identify particular sonar imagery that could be of interest for us to look at later, and then cross-reference with the magnetic data that we collected. And so we can add that into our ArcMap database and then lay in the magnetic data to see if those two mesh together.
So it's sort of a lengthy process to just keep weeding down and distilling until we get, you know, 20, 30, or 40 anomalies that we would really like to investigate further. This is our high pressure water pump, so it's forcefully shooting water, and so we'll have a fire hose going out and it'll be shooting water, and we'll use it for two devices. One is a hydro probe, so we'll reduce the fire hose to a garden hose, and then we'll put it to a 10-foot pipe, and then we'll just methodically punch through the sand of ocean bottom to make contact with a buried target. And so if it's deeper than 10 feet, we're really not going to dig that, so at least we know it's deeper, and we can come back with another instrument called a sub-bottom profiler to see if it's a target that may look like a cannon or something. Then we also power excavation, a dredge pump, so we can dredge and remove the sand. So we find a shallower target, we can dredge down and try and find the identity of the target. Yes, this is our handheld magnetometer. So this, you know, we found a magnetic target using our boat towed sensor. And with this, the diver can bring it down to the target and then try and isolate exactly where the target is. The cap I'm going to put in the boat box. Really, the best remote sensing tools are our eyes. And so that's why we try and prioritize our targets, which ones we want to dive, and then go dive and find out if it's historical or archaeologically significant. And then when we go dive, visibility can range from either terrible to good further out. So when you're closer in the harbor, it's a little more turbid. You go further offshore, it's been pretty nice out there. And usually we try to aim for spring and fall when the biology is a little less, you know, less algae and things like that.
That's two.
Through! Back it up. That seemed pretty tight. The anchor line seems tight.
Yep.
All right, I think we're good. All right, let's just hang here and we'll get ready. Me and Amber will get ready to dive. On this dive, we're going to bring down the proton magnetometer so that we can determine if we're going to find the magnetic anomaly. So right now, we're just trying to get ourselves situated by getting the boat attached to our downline so the divers can go up and down, use it like a highway. All right, okay. Corsair was a vessel that was a blend between a privateer, meaning they had authority from the King of France to attack enemies of the king, so Spain or Portugal, and a blend of a pirate as well. So sort of two perspectives of what a corsair is. To the French, you know, they're simply a group of businessmen looking for a return on investment. To the Spanish, they're pirates. The 16th century of American history is usually called the forgotten century. People really don't know much about that. You know, most people figure United States history starts in Jamestown, but it's 100 years before that. And so that's really what helps Le Prince bring that into record. We've looked at a 18th century nautical chart that shows like how the tide ebbs and floods into the harbor. So if the poop deck made it in, it had to have been drawn into the sound, and like how far away was the wreck offshore to where it could have been drawn inshore. And so we figured, based on this one map we researched, about 3 miles is right where something out that far can be drawn into the sound. You start getting further out, it starts heading towards Hilton Head or away from the sound. So that's why we feel confident of, you know, we're in the right area. We just need to methodically keep covering that area. At this point, we can confidently state we know where Le Prince isn't. So that is something that we can then build on and just keep going around. But I can say that with a little bit of a caveat, because we haven't dove all our targets yet. So for all I know, we do have the wreck. We just need to go dive the wreck.